Hello, malty Miami Hurricanes, and thank you to Mike Sierra for that malt mention. Introducing Whisky Review 497, which, after a short series of older Scotch single malt reviews, we're bringing the age of the malt down a little bit this time to the more, what you would call a standard age, between 10 and 12. This is a 13-year-old single malt. Unusual to get whiskies bottled at that age because it's considered an unlucky number. However, it does pop up now and again. You have a 13-year-old White & Mackay. I've spotted that recently. But 13-year-old whiskies are few and far between. So here's one. I'm going to review it for you. Craigellachie. Have you heard of it? It's Gaelic for Rocky Hill. This is a Speyside distillery, which sits very near a Rocky Hill. And it tends to be fairly invisible from standard bottlings. This is one of these phenomenons due to the increased popularity of single malts and the demand for single malts. Malt whiskey distilleries in Scotland, which previously have not really featured on the malt map, they've been mainly providing for blenders, have been wanting to cash in on the trend, understandably. Tomatin is a good example of that. And here's another distillery, which you may not have heard of, which is now been relaunched as a series of single malts. Craigellachie. 13-year-old, there's a 17-year-old, and there's a 23-year-old. The 23-year-old, certainly in the UK, in Britain, in my opinion, is extortionately expensive, and I will not be touching it with a barge pole because of the price. However, much more acquirable, much more budgetable, is the 13-year-old version. All the range are bottled at 46% unchill filtered, and as you can see, if I hold this bottle carefully forward, if you take a note of good note of that colour, that slight kind of rich barley sugar straw colour, that is not the colour of the addition of E150A caramel colourant. It does not have that orange glow about it. An old-fashioned label, but in whiskey, Scotch whiskey, old-fashioned is cool. The more old-fashioned, the better. In fact, they even go as far to say in the label that it was old-fashioned in 1891. If you've ever tasted this whiskey before, it's probably part of the Dewar's blended whiskey range. It's a distillery that features quite prominently in the Dewar's range, which in my opinion are quite good, particularly the 12-year-old. Anyway, nose, taste, malt mark. When I first opened this bottle, it was really quite astringent. It was very green smelling, spirity. It was difficult. Frankly, it was difficult. I struggled with the first glass, and I was wondering to myself, should I really be reviewing this? But naturally, as I've mentioned to you in several occasions now, malt mates, never judge a book by its cover or take a whiskey on first impressions. Some whiskies can dazzle you in first impressions and then subsequently become quite uninspiring, positively boring at times. Other whiskies can be quite awkward on first acquaintance, and yet once you get to know them and they settle down in the opened bottle with the air circulating about, softening things up, you can get quite an evolution in your relationship, and that's exactly what's happened here. This, in my opinion, slightly spirity, bitter syrup, vegetal, herbal, astringent. There is still that astringency on the nose, although it has barley sugared up quite a lot since I've opened the bottle. I would almost call the nose phenolic. Now, I've got to quantify this statement. We're not talking phenolic as in peaty, because this essentially is not a peated whisky. It's an absolute typical Speysider, but we tend to associate Speysiders with sweetness and a certain richness. This is the antithesis of that. This is a bitter Speysider, and that's why it takes a while to get to know it, but there's a certain reward to be found. Butter candy, ginger, white pepper, not a lot of spice going on, any spice, very mild clove, nutmeg, allspice, lemon rind, there's a lot of rind going on in the nose. And time to add some water. Generally you'll find yourself adding more water to younger whiskies because the experience is more spirit dominated rather than cask dominated. Gentle roll around the glass, no shaky swilly splashes. Already the nose is becoming a little more articulate. It's not changing in terms of character, but it's becoming a little more segregated into its components. It's contributing smells. The phenolic note is green, bitter, mint, chlorophyll, camphorish, wintergreen, phenols. What you call a green whiskey. Now, interestingly, these are notes that appear in Irish pot still whiskey and fairly unblended single malts from Ireland. I'll come back to that this shortly. The last time I've smelt this in a couple of blends, the same character in Hanky Bannister Heritage and in Bailey Nickel Jarvie blend, both green, slightly astringent, non-sweet whiskies. Taste. Very cleansing in the palate. Bitter. Big on bitter. Sour. Green. Mint. Spearmint. Loads of it. Vanilla. Very dry vanilla. Bitter honey. Manuka. Touch of that. In first acquaintance, this seems a thin, spirity whiskey. But you'll find that, given a bit of time as you get more used to it, that the sweetness really from the bourbon casks is balancing things off and turning this into quite an interesting, different single malt experience. The form is good. Oh, lovely in the development, candy oak, lozenges, throat pastels. This doesn't sound terribly attractive, but I'm enjoying this. This is not an easy access malt. It is demanding, but there's also rewards with it. It tends to feature Craigellachie routinely in independent bottlers. But if it's a refill cask, that's a third refill, if the cask hasn't done enough, it really is just a disappointing experience and not worth the money. Craigellachie works when you've got fresh casks, when you've got sweet casks, to balance off the astringency that is coming from this very singular spirit. There's a growing complexity with the wood, where the wood and the spirit meet. It's the wood that's sweet, it's the spirit that's bitter. That's an unusual combination. Very clean finish, very refreshing in the palate. If you like Old Pulteney, for example, you will enjoy this. If you prefer sweet whiskies like Strathyla, Fettercairn, you won't be taken with this at all. I can imagine that Craigellachie could produce some amazing peated, heavily peated spirit, because behind quite a number of the Islay peated spirits, Kulila, Laphroaig, Ardbeg, you have actually quite dry, complex malts. That is what makes them so successful at delivering and presenting the element of peatiness. And this could be amazing. Also is a pot still whiskey, and I'll come back to that shortly. I'm going to give a malt mark now. One more sip, a few more comments, then a malt mark. Steady arrival, dry port, mint, bittersweet, sour, grapefruit, lemon rind, citrus rind, honey malt oak, slight hint of char. The char note tends to recede from the experience as the bottle goes down. Finish, very light in tannins, but there's a tannin crispness in the finish due to the astringency of the spirit. It's a demanding but a rewarding one. Malt marks? Let me see now. Yeah. I'm going to rate this probably higher than some might be expecting, but I'll give a reason for that. Malt mark, 86 out of 100. Now, that's a relatively high malt mark that I'm giving this, but the reason for that is quite simple. This is a singular, characterful whisky. The spirit is well made. That comes across. There's a certain richness to that dry bitterness and that sourness. It's the balance within the casks. You won't notice it in first tasting, but as you get to know the bottle, it'll become much more apparent. This is a moving whisky. It's an evolving whisky in the bottle, and it's an old-fashioned style which has fallen out of favour, but is reappearing due to demand for single malts. And for any of you who are looking to expand your range of single malt experiences, this is a good place to go. Also, if you're a fan of Irish whiskey, because you get so few, I'll reword that, because there are so few Irish distilleries, and because they are dominated by corporate multinationals who carefully engineer their experience to provide for volume of sales, I think you know what I mean by that statement, you tend to have, you don't have the real old-fashioned character Irish whiskies that you used to get in the late 19th, early 20th century prior to Prohibition. Ireland produced amazing whiskies. You're talking great big pot stills, triple distilled, producing a clean, fresh, but in many respects a characterful, dry, vegetal, herbal spirit, which was clearly a different taste, a different experience from Scotch whisky at the time, which was dominated by inferior blends. Now you know. And what I find myself tasting here with this Craigellachie 13-year-old is, in fact, an Irish whisky. So if you want to taste an Irish whiskey that's no longer made these days, this is the one you'll find it. One of the nearest you'll get to it is Tyrconnell. And Greenore, superb whiskey. And I really look forward to the small distilleries providing some original, authentic stuff, you know, as is from the still, not trying to cater the product and add Irishness. Irish whiskey doesn't need more Irishness. The fact that it's made where it is quite enough and says it all. So if you're looking for a taste of what Irish whiskey could be, here you are. Interestingly, Craigellachie are one of the few distilleries in Scotland who cool their spirit after it's passed out the still and it goes into the cooling system. It's not a cooling sleeve, which tends to be more industrial and efficient and rapid in condensing the spirit vapour prior to going into through the still safe and into the receiving tanks. The old-fashioned system is to use worm tubs, and when you go on do your online research for pot stills, you see the curly-whirly spiral of copper piping in a pot. That's a worm tub. Mortlach use worm tubs. Springbank use worm tubs. They do make a difference, without a doubt. And Craigellachie use worm tubs. There are a few others. There should be many more. In fact, if I was the mandarin of making whiskey in Scotland, I would probably be quite unpopular with many distillers initially, because I would insist that there'll be two grades of Scotch single malt. There will be standard grade and premium grade. Standard grade would be carry on and produce as normal, but premium grade single malt, 46% unchilled filtered, direct fired stills, warm tubs, dunnage warehouses, and no messing about with casks. The one and done policy. One cask, one maturation. That's it. No titivating the results. That, of course, will never happen. Not in a month of Sundays. To which some distillers are going, phew, the last thing we want is Ralphie in charge. Well, that's a topic for another day, actually. Really enjoying this, actually. I wasn't to begin with, but I persevered. Oh, a real crisp, unripe melon, apple, green apple, a tartness in there that you get associated with unripe apples. If you're up for a challenge, this'll do the job. Anyway, I'm Ralphie. Thank you for watching. I'm just having a wee checklist here. I've written down to see if there's anything I've missed. No, I haven't missed a single thing. Fantastic. I hope you'll join me again for Whiskey Review 498, which will be coming along shortly. I think I'll probably be reviewing a Glenmorangie. The very opposite. I mean, these distilleries are quite near each other, Craigellachie, and relatively near, Craigellachie, I'm thinking of Ben Romach, actually. Craigellachie's in the centre of Speyside. I was thinking of Ben Romach. So forget what I was saying. I'm starting to waffle a little bit, so I'll just tidy things up nicely, raise my glass, salute your good health, and hope to see you soon. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.